Good morning. Welcome to Calvary Chapel, Lincoln City. We're glad you're here visiting today, or we're glad that this is your home church, or we're glad if you're just here trying to figure out if this might be your home church. One way or the other, we're glad you're here. And to those of you that are here just checking it out, and maybe you don't even know the Lord Jesus yet, we're especially glad you're here. Come and find out the truth. You guys, there's cool stuff in the foyer. We've got the latest Calvary Chapel magazine. Feel free to grab a copy. There's some really fun pictures in there from the Jesus Movement and Pastor Chuck and just a lot of cool stuff. And I know that a lot of you guys were part of that. So you might find you in there. You never know. So take a peek. But there's fun stuff in there. Always feel free to grab the magazines in the foyer up on the rack. We only get a few, but if you want one, take one. That is what they're there for. Grab them. Check out the history of Calvary. Guys, those of you that are on our text list, if you aren't on our text list and you want to be, all we do is use it for reminders like, hey, men's breakfast tomorrow or an event coming up. Or sometimes someone will reach out in the community and say, hey, we need help. And it's really quick for me to just send a text at work and be like, can anyone help? And I want to say 11 out of 10 times, somebody responds and we help. So it really is working. It's effective. Guys, if you want to be on that and you're not, just come talk to me or my phone number is in the bulletin. Unfortunately, it's bottom left first page and it's crossed out because it's associated with men's Bible study. Still my phone number. You just got to read between that line, crossing it out. Shoot me a text, guys. Like, hey, it's me, Joe. I sit fifth row back on the left, second service. Perfect, Joe. I don't remember what you look like. I had glasses and wild hair. Perfect. I still don't remember. But maybe next week. But then I'll respond back, hey, Joe, great. You're on the list now. So feel free. Shoot me a text anytime. Those of you who have ever tried to call me, I'm always working. I'm always raising kids. Or I'm always churching. So I rarely answer my phone, but if you text, I will get back to you right away. Big texter. Be part of that. Guys, it's a phenomenal part of the ministry around here. Because of the fact that our leadership team is going to a conference this week, Monday through Wednesday at Calvary Chapel Corvallis, a really good time of refreshment and growth for the leadership team here at this church. I'm very excited to attend with them. That means two things. One, if you guys, the body, would please be praying for us all week as you think about it. A number of us have been praying and fasting the last few days that the Lord would be ahead of us moving to this conference and doing things while we're gone for those 3 days. Those of you that like what the Lord is doing here, those of you that are feeling the draw to be part of what Jesus is doing here, please pray for us. We're seeking the Lord to see how it is to move the church forward. So we'll be at that. But because of that, there'll be no men's study Tuesday. Ladies, you will still be on Tuesday morning at 10 and evening at 7. So will be canceled, the youth group, the So ministry. So if you were looking forward to men's or youth, I'm sorry. Neil's will still be on Monday night. Neil's group will still be here, so you guys can get in on that. Just don't show up and be like, oh, no. Or maybe you can. That's okay, too, and just hang out. We'll put you to work if you do. Men's breakfast, Saturday at 8:30 here at the church, guys. Second and fourth Saturdays we have men's breakfast. Come be part of it. Good time of learning to share our testimonies and encourage the other guys. And that thing ranges from 10 guys to 35 guys any given Saturday. It's a lot of fun. Come out and be part of it. Barbecue this Saturday, number 2, July 22nd. Come be part of it. There's flyers at the door. Take some. Invite your friends. This is our church's low-risk, high-grace attempt at bringing in our neighbors, coworkers, friends, those who aren't believers, saying, hey, just come to a barbecue. We're not going to preach at them. There's no message. There's no worship service. It'll just be coming and hanging out, where we will secretly be worshiping God by being friendly, and they will be coming to find out that the reality of Christianity is that we're fun and we're normal. In fact, we're the real normal. I say that a lot of people. We are the real normal. We are real life. We are what God intended. So let's show them what it looks like. Come be part of that. The Lutheran Church, up halfway through town, they're having a VBS. And I know it's not our church, but I want to let you guys know they've got 26 kids already that are signed up, and they want to do their VBS July 31st through August 4th. So I know this is short notice. But if you're feeling drawn to do kid stuff, and you haven't joined the Kidmen here at our church, and you want to help out in the community, they are looking for people, godly people. In fact, specifically the email said, mature, godly Christians. So if you're like, I'm week 2 in Jesus, maybe not. Maybe, I don't know. But they asked for mature Christians. I'm not really sure what that means because I think that's pretty ambiguous. But they like people who love the Lord, who love kids, who would like to come serve in their VBS. So if you're interested, talk to Pastor Phil or myself and we'll get you connected with that. We're got a park. Outreach, the 12th. We're just a little under a month away now. We've done this before in years past. We're going to go out there and have some music, some food, testimony, hanging out, We're going to have tracts available. We're going to have people ready to share the gospel. If you want to come be part of it, if you want to come hang out with us on August 12th at Regatta Park, we're going to be there from 10 to 2. The event will be 11 to 1, but we'll be there early to set up and there to clean up. Come out. We got a permit. We got the spot. We're going to hang out in there. We're just going to share in the community. If that interests you, come down. Talk to Pastor Phil. We'll get you hooked up. Other than that, those are all in your bulletins. So I really didn't need to read them, but I just like to emphasize them. It's like, I have no idea what he just said. It's cool. It's all written in your bulletin. Just read it when you get home. Be like, yeah, I'd like to be part of that. You guys, we're always looking for ways for people to serve in the church because that's how the church grows. People come to us a lot as a leadership team and say, hey, your church should do this. Great. When are you starting? And that's how it works. And you're like, oh, the church needs this. Well, then come on down. Pray about it. Come on down. This week, I just want to preface. I gave warning to first service. I'll give you guys the same warning. First service was okay. Nobody attacked me afterwards. We're going to talk about some stuff today that not everybody likes to hear. We're going to get real personal today. The music was great this morning. The message is going to be heavy and hard. So buckle up, sit down, wait to hear the whole sermon before you start throwing things. Okay, we're going to speak God's word this morning. There's a story that it's, who knows how long it's been floating around. The internet just quotes unknown. It's one of those, but I remember it from my childhood days. I don't remember who even told it to me, but I thought I would look it up, and internet finds everything today. It's great. Traveler is going along through the desert. He's thirsty. Comes upon a well spigot. Spigot's there. He's like, oh, yes, and he's walking closer. He's sweating. He's thirsty. There's actually a container, a little container just full of water already pumped, and it's clear and cool. He's like, yes, just dive right in. He's reaching for it, and there's a sign. The sign says, please use this water to pour into the pump first and prime it. And then pump all you want. Drink until it's just coming out of your ears. And then please leave one full bucket for the next person. He's thirsty. He's very thirsty. He thinks, okay, one, I'm thirsty now. I want it now. I want what I want. And I'll just drink that. Well, maybe. Maybe I'll prime it. What if the pump doesn't work? What if I pour it in and no water comes out? I could have drank that water. It was there. Oh, I'm so thirsty. What if no one's coming after me anyway? Or what if I don't even care? Who cares? I'm just going to drink the water. There's this grappling right here with this sign, this wisdom this guy has. He can either believe that it's important that the water's there, that the pump needs to be primed, or he can really believe someone's going to come after him. Maybe have a little forethought. Well, I don't want the next guy to be as thirsty as me. There's so many avenues he could take. But does he really trust the wisdom? Does he really trust putting himself aside to trust in the wisdom that was already written there and say, okay, I'm going to believe this, and I'm going to think about the next guy down the line? And I'm guessing at least 99% of you, if not all of you, already figured out, like, oh, yeah, I hear the Bible in there, right? This is what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about our rights. We're going to talk about what Paul says about the church. There's this similar moment in Scripture that really struck me as I was reading this week. It's the time that we get to see Solomon's first real act of wisdom. And when Solomon speaks that wisdom, he does so in a crazy, nefarious, grotesque situation. Maybe you know the story, maybe not. If you haven't heard it, 1 Kings 3, you can turn there if you want, but I'm just going to kind of paraphrase it. There's this moment where these two harlots, okay, they're already not savory characters. They're doing what harlots do. They both end up pregnant. They both live in the same harlot house together, whatever they were calling them then. And one of them in the night, 3 days in, rolls over on her new baby, smothers the baby to death, kills the baby. They wake up in the morning, two unsavory women as it is, fighting over a baby. It's my baby. I want that baby. And so, you know what we do? We'll go to the king. So they go before Solomon. They come to him, and one says, that's my baby, and she's yanking at this poor little baby, and the one says, that's my baby, and what do we do? And Solomon says, wait, quiet down. I know how to fix this. I know how to fix this. Guard, bring a sword. Is it sharp? Real sharp. The women are looking at him. What's going on? Okay, put the baby on the floor. I see that you both very much desire a baby. So I've got a great plan. We're going to cut your baby in half. You can each go home with a baby. Half. One woman cries out, falls to her knees, says, let her have the baby. Solomon says, perfect. That's the real mom, right? That's just how it is. One of the women in this story is willing to sacrifice, to give up custody of her own child, that her child's life may be saved. How many here are willing to give up their children, that their children might be saved? Like that hits home, doesn't it? The other woman is willing to do whatever it takes to make the other woman feel as bad as she does, so that everybody's as miserable as her, to get her way, to make sure everyone knows my pain and I get my way. There's such a contrast here. One woman is willing to be defrauded for posterity. The other woman is willing to fight to the death to get what she wants. It's going on in the church all the time. You watching churches fall apart? You've probably been to some of those churches that are fighting internally, that are falling apart, that are taking each other to law over the things that God has already proclaimed you can do within by my wisdom, by my power. When we pick that foolish road and we start promoting the confusion, what do we do? How do we handle this? How do we resolve this? When we don't rely on God's plan, we throw the church into a massive state of confusion, which is where we are right now. The church worldwide is in a state of confusion. You can see it all over the place. Our key verse, if you're just visiting today or you're new here and thinking about staying here, we've been traveling through the book of 1 Corinthians. We're looking at the confused church that Paul has some wisdom for from God. And our key verse is 1 Corinthians 14:33. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. He's not confusing. Why is it then that we make him so confusing? Saints, we are empowered with the wisdom of the one who created the whole universe. If you have not yet come to that belief or understanding, reconcile that today. He simply said, let there be. And it was, out of his own generosity for us, to have relationship with us, wisdom from on high. And yet we have taken in the church to say, we've been called to perpetuate his plan, to be stewards of it, and yet we've come from this aspect of using the world's wisdom and the world's laws to maintain God's church. God says that's not going to work. There's three things Paul's going to talk about here, just in this first opening paragraph. He's going to talk about acknowledging God's wisdom, that it is real, that it does exist, that it is here in the church, and that every single one of us has access to it all the way. Two, he's going to talk about how and when to apply God's wisdom. How and when to apply it. When should we use it? Three, this is the hard one. This is the one that sticks a lot of us right there. Like, I hear that. How we view God's wisdom through the lens of our personal rights. How we view God's wisdom through the lens of our personal rights. Lord, give us your Holy Spirit this morning. Speak to us deeply, Lord. I'm only going to share what you've put on my heart, Lord, and you're going to do all the rest. Lord, you're going to speak it. You're going to convict. You're going to build. You're going to break down. You're going to humble. You're going to exalt. We're looking for you to work this morning, Jesus. Thank you for the opportunity to be here to serve you. Receive all the glory. And all his saints said, amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to go ahead and turn there real quick. First Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you point those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? I say this to your shame. It is so that there is not a wise man among you. I'm sorry, is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren? But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Thanks, Paul. Listen, Paul's up to his eyeballs in the church, taking things into their own hands. The church has decided to make this separation right? Not the good kind of separation of church and state, but they've decided to make a separation where they get to pick and choose which ones, and sometimes we use the state to take care of our business, sometimes we use the church, and whoever kind of fits us. They're in a culture, Israel is in particular, where they're under Roman occupation. They don't really have a lot of rights, right? They know they've got to check in with the local governors and authority to do things. And the government's pushing it, just as they are today to some degree, although the tides seem to be turning today for noticing where the government wants to put its hands in God's business. They want to have some say in some of the things that we do. But there's this culture, there's this moment where the church is like, oh yeah, I guess we need the law. I guess we need the world to help run the church where God intended never to be off of his throne or to give them a king, but rather to just be their king and their God. Look at John 18, 29 through 31. Then Pilate went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? They answered and said to him, if he were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him up to you. And Pilate said to them, you take him. You judge him according to your law. Therefore the Jews said to him, it's not lawful for us to put anyone to death. I'm just going to capture a small piece of that big chunk of scripture, that hypocrisy stab. You got people who claim to submit to God and run things as God tells them to by his law. And they're like, oh, please, Rome, please help us do things that are wrong. Please come and help us with our little problems. The hypocrisy. Pilate's like, you take him. This isn't my problem. This is your laws. He said he's your king. He's not my king. My king is Caesar. But why would they try and drag him in? But that's what they do. Look at Acts 18. Paul, in another riot, can you believe it? In another riot, getting dragged before people again, in chains again. This seems to be Paul's thing. In Acts 18, it says, when Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews with one accord rose up against Paul, brought him to the judgment seat, saying, this fellow persuades men to worship God contrary to the law. And Paul is about to open his mouth. Shh! Gallio says, I don't even care. Be quiet. He says, if it were a matter of wrongdoing or wicked crimes, O Jews, there would be reason why I should bear with you. But it's a question of words and names with your own law. Look to it yourselves. I do not want to be a judge over such matters. And he drove them from the judgment seat. So don't bother me with this. This is your business. Oh, how right he was. It's not his business. It's not the business of the world or the unbeliever to be involved in the judgmental issues within the church. It's a church's job to submit to the only judge, the only true judge. Allow him to fix things. Church, we've gotten to a point sometimes. When I say church, I want you guys to recognize. I am speaking to us specifically, and I'm speaking to the church, the general. When you guys know what the church should look like and what it shouldn't look like. The church, the one holy church around the whole world that Jesus Christ is in charge of. It's gotten to this point where we've made some distinction and discernment between heavenly wisdom and earthly wisdom. And we have come to a place where we neglect to use that heavenly wisdom. We start to use man's wisdom and we start to question things. Peter has this question in Matthew 22. He says, what do we do with our taxes here? And Jesus comes to him. He says, whose image and inscription is this on the coin? Show me that denarius. And he looks it over. It's old Caesar's. And he said to them, render to Caesar's. What is Caesar's? And the things that are God to God. He said, well, yeah, right there. He makes this distinction between man and the world. No, what he does is he says, listen, all things are my business. Render to the world what's theirs and leave it with them. But the witness that you set by rendering unto man the things that honor him as well while glorifying God have such a further reach than going down there to argue about why we're paying taxes for this. Well, I don't agree with that. Now I'm following a lawsuit. And just go pay the taxes and quit whining. Set a good witness. Go down there and say, I'm happy to do this. Thank you for the civil services that you provide for us. The witness stretches so far into the world, you guys. God has so many commands on how we treat the world. Jesus says that heavenly wisdom trumps both man's wisdom and God's wisdom, right? It's all from here. You start here. There's no starting point with man's wisdom. In Titus 2, Paul gives this sharp rebuke about how to act so that the world will buy into what we're selling. It says, in all these things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works. In doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned. That one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. exhort bondservants to be obedient to their own masters, to be well-pleasing in all things, not answering back, not pilfering, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. How do you show the world that you're secure and that you're not worried and that you value them when you're busy fighting them, when you're busy grabbing for your own, when you're busy making sure you have your stuff, my rights, respect me? That's not gonna be a witness. My wife and I were driving out to Portland yesterday. It was a disgusting 103 degrees. Ugh. Got back to Lincoln City, it was 64. I was like, praise Jesus for the coast. So good. And we were talking about laying down our rights because we were talking about the sermon. And she said, you know, something she had watched, a really great piece on Martin Luther King Jr. when he stepped out to lead the civil rights movement. When he stepped out to say, listen, the black people of America are the exact same value as the white people. And when he called them in, he said, listen to me, everybody who's going to march with me and go with me, when we go out there, they're going to spit on you. They're going to hurt you. They're going to imprison you. And when they do it, you're not going to spit back. You're not going to fight back. You're not going to be angry back. You're going to pray for them. Because if you don't, you're giving them reason to say, you're asking for value, yet you show none. This is how it is. This is the life of a Christian like Dr. King Jr. Because that's where his movement came from. His faith in God, who said all life is valued. All of it. But church, we don't get to fight back. 1 Peter 5:6 says, listen, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. The man or woman of God who doesn't realize that God cares for them, they're fighting to get their own. Now keep listening. Hear me out, because I know people are already starting to itch about, what do you mean we don't get to fight back? What do you mean? I'm armed and ready to go. That's fine. You can be armed. For those of you that are armed, I'm thankful. We had a heated discussion in our men's study this Tuesday. It was awesome. A couple of the guys from first service were in it, and some guys here were, and it was heated. But I tell you what, we got to the bottom line and said that the judgment here wasn't lying on who owns a gun and who doesn't. It was lying on what your heart's intent is to do with that gun and what your heart's intent is for God's people and how you view the value of human life. It's a big difference. Nothing in having value for people precludes or excludes you from having or not having a weapon. But what you're going to do with it does. 100%. Peter says, those who humble themselves under the Lord and cast all of their cares on their God will not have a need to fight for their own rights. God has made it abundantly clear. And listen, I can hear my father-in-law right now. This is not a political sermon. Don't take it there. Okay? I'm not talking about not voting for good laws and standing up for wrong. I'm talking about fighting. I'm talking about suing. We're talking about exactly what Paul's talking about. God has made it abundantly clear that he not only loves us and desires us. Matthew 10, 20 through 30 says, every hair on our head is numbered. Not a sparrow from the sky falls he doesn't know about. He's in control. That's the bottom line. He's in control and he loves us. And better than that, I want us to be empowered, you guys. I want you guys to realize you have special privilege. You have special access to wisdom that we can't even comprehend, to the wisdom that holds all things together throughout eternity, right here, living inside. And yet we look to man's laws, and we look to man's wisdom. All of it's right here. You guys, take advantage of the love that our God has for us. Take advantage of the access to privilege you have. You know, I know that word privilege is a bad thing, right? You're privileged. I am privileged. I am privileged in Jesus Christ to have inherited eternity and to have his wisdom to operate in here day to day. I am special. I am privileged. And so are you guys. And so are all of Jesus's people, period. But Paul says, why would you take it to the unbeliever? Spiritually speaking, what is the unbeliever? They are dead. Why would you go to a corpse for wisdom? You remember Saul going to the witch at Endor. Do you remember Saul going there and saying, oh, I've got this earthly problem. I know what I'll do. I'll go to this witch, this medium, and I'll seek wisdom from the dead. All the time now, right? Supermarket's got horoscopes right there, and you can go play Ouija board, and all sorts of things went on. I shared a story first service. I'm just going to make a glance, let her know. There's no names, but we have a friend here in the church whose daughter was being babysat while she was out during the day for work, and her daughter was in a home that had literal devil worship going on, tarot cards and things like this. She came and she shared that with the leadership here, and we said, just take her out right now. Don't ever send her back. We will watch her. Anybody in our church will watch her. And a family stepped right up, so we'll take her. And she told my wife and I a few weeks ago that the change has been remarkable. You can't even access. Her daughter, everything has changed. We can't be part of that church. We don't go to the world. We don't go to the dead. The world before Christ is dead. Don't seek any wisdom from them. We're going to judge the whole world. This is what he's called for his people. This is what he's called for his people. Luke 22 says, but you are those who have continued with me in my trials, and I bestow upon you a kingdom, just as my Father bestowed one upon me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. These are human beings, his creations that he's speaking to. You will sit on thrones with me and judge those who have claimed my name. That's a pretty big deal. And yet I'm so scared to make a little judgment here. I just let the law handle that. Brothers and sisters, we can't. Jude verse 14 and 15 says, now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men, also saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. That's a lot of ungodly. And Jesus is returning with his tens of thousands of saints to judge the works of man. Certainly we can do it here now in the way that God intended. Revelation 3:21 says, to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. That picture of our God whose Son overcomes the world and goes to judge on the behalf, and who comes to us now and says, you can sit on the throne with me and judge. You guys, we have so much power. That first point, we have to acknowledge that the wisdom of God is right here. It really is right here within us. That's where we have to start and say, we're going to judge by God's wisdom. When and how to use that heavenly wisdom, this seems to be the problem. When do we apply it? Well, like I said, it should be all the time. It should be all the time. But as a purveyor of personalities, as a person who has been a really bad guy and done some really bad things, that in the Lord's grace I have not ended up in prison for. And on the other hand, now for being redeemed in Christ, and once hating marriage, now desiring marriage and promoting marriage, once hating children, loving children, having 8 children, having grandbabies, as who once loved the flesh, now sees the complete power of Satan through drugs and alcohol in people's lives. Listen. There's a place that bothers me. I see where we have trouble saying, when will we use God's wisdom? When will we use man's wisdom? It's always God's wisdom. The problem that I see in us, the problem that I see in me, that thing that seems to push us over to man's wisdom is when expedience is involved. What do you mean? When I need it now, I'm angry today. You hit my car, I want that headlight fixed today. You took from me, I want it back now. Or we're going to court. It's happening in the church all the time. People in the church are treating people like people in the world all the time. Taking their problems and going before the people who don't have any wisdom, treating each other poorly while at the same time going to people who have no idea what's going on. They really can't discern because they have no God to call on. Me. What about me? Send for me. I have needs right now. Me, me, me. You know, it's easy when there's not like a lot on the line, right? When it's no big thing. Maybe there's no money involved. It's not really a big deal. It's real easy to say, oh, brother, sister, all is forgiven. No problem. I am so graceful. Then it comes down to like, hey, dude, you owe me like $50. Come on, pay up. But it happens a lot. It happens a lot. And I want us to see that I understand both sides of the coin, too. I spent a lot of time thinking about that. For those of you that are starting to grip or see, well, that, what about, that's not fair. Listen, just keep listening. I get it. There's two sides of the coin. The first side is the believer who has been offended. The believer who's been offended, guess what your job is? To humble yourself before the Lord and understand that the Lord cares for you and cast all your cares on him. That's your job. But wait, no, wait, you didn't hear. I only said therefore. There wasn't a but. That's it. You have to believe that our God cares for us. You have to believe that our God provides for us. If you've not yet experienced it, give Jesus a chance. Let him start doing great things in your life. So that believer that's offended, you got to take a big old breath. You got to calm down. Relax. An employee called me Friday morning. He had gone on vacation, and he didn't check his PTO, his paid time off. And at our company, once you pass 3 years, you start getting 80 hours. And once you pass 5 years, you can get 120 hours. My boss is very generous. It only requires 40 hours by state law. But he starts actually giving us vacation time. He forgot to check how much PTO he had. He took 2 weeks off, came back. He got a four-hour paycheck when he returned. It's all the PTO he had. He called me up so mad. First off, I don't do our payroll or report the hours. I manage our construction. Going, you got to fix this. I said, take a breath. Call me back in 10 minutes. Just relax. It is not the end of the world, believer. You're hearing, it's the end of the world. No, it's not. Not only is it not literally the end of the world, because we're not in the tribulation yet. The 7 years has not started yet, and I have not seen it starting yet. In fact, I see the Lord reviving right now before we get there. It's not time quite yet. He's still picking his saints up, and there's still a lot of us to come to Jesus. A lot of us. Keep praying. It's not the end of the world in your day-to-day either. It really isn't. Now, on the other hand, the other side of the coin is the believer that offended. When that believer has committed an offense and that brother or sister comes to them per Matthew 18, 1:1 and says, hey, we got to work this out. That believer that has come to you has to act quick, now. Don't drag your feet. I'm getting to it. I'm thinking about it. Now. I get it. If you're the believer dragging your feet, guess what you're doing? You're causing impatience to the one that you've offended. And at some point, you might not find yourself resolving in a church anymore. It takes both parties. So if you're dealing with that brother or sister who's dragging their feet, you remind them. And Matthew 18 gives you really good grounds to go on, one-on-one, and then one-on with some unbiased parties, and then before the elders and the pastor, and then kick them out. Then you go to law. You do what you need to do. But the church has specific ways to deal with problems. Proverbs 3:27-28 says, do not withhold good from those to whom it is due, when it is in the power of your hand to do so. Do not say to your neighbor, go and come back tomorrow, I will give it, when you have it with you. And I understand that Solomon's not specifically talking about rectifying a problem here. But this general doctrine, listen, do it now. Do good now. Don't wait. Forgiveness is good. Forgiving is good. Being forgiven is good. Do it now. What are you waiting for? James 2 says, the man who knows what to do and doesn't do it, that's sin. That's sin. You're like, oh yeah, I didn't commit any sins today, but I omitted some stuff. Omission is sin, just like sin. Sin is sin is sin. Sin. James says, do good. Don't hold back. You're sinning. You're causing a bigger beef here. Matthew 5 says, therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there, remember that your brother has something against you. Stop right there. Get up. It says, leave your gift before the altar. Don't even bother God. You got some business to handle. Go handle it. Fix the problem quickly. It says, listen, just drop the gift right there. Don't come before me, God says. Go and apologize. We don't come to church to pray that somebody would forgive us. We go and we ask them to forgive us. We go apologize to them. We go make it right. We go reconcile. At that point, if they choose not to, then you pray for them. You are now biblically relieved. Don't be bitter towards them anymore. You've given them forgiveness. You're done. You've asked for it. Love them. Pray for them. But God is so serious. Jesus says, don't even come to my altar. Just drop it there and go. Go fix it. Why? If not, because we see person two in here. agree with your adversary quickly while you're on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge. You'd be handed over to the officer and thrown into prison. Church, that's what happens when we can't resolve it. And as everyone in this church knows, visitors, you're going to learn it today, we hate the word irreconcilable differences. It is anti-Christian. It is not in the Bible, and we will not use that term. There's no such thing as irreconcilable differences among God's children. Period. If you cannot reconcile, your heart is hard and stony, and you're all about you. Me, 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 me. Galatians 6. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Our leadership group Friday, we meet in the mornings, and Jasmine and Clyde were quoting from the NLT Bible, and it says, that particular verse says, man, you're just not that important. Just like, that's it. You're just not that important. It says, listen, you deceive yourself. Calm down, take a breath, step back. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For each one shall bear his own load. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Let us not grow weary, church, in doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. He tells us, listen, you got to treat people outside well. How much more the church? Act quickly in wisdom. James 3 just gives us such a definition of God's wisdom. It says, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure. Just start there when you're angry. Are my thoughts pure? Is what I want back from them pure? Is how I'm going to talk to them pure? Is reconciliation really my goal in my heart? If it's not, then just be quiet. Go back to Jesus and pray some more. Don't even approach them yet. Is it peaceable? It's peaceable. It's gentle. Oh, it's willing to yield. But if I'm willing to yield, what's in it for me? Eternity. Eternity. Relax. Full of mercy. Good fruits. Without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace. By who? By those who make peace. You're not making peace if you're fighting for your rights. You're not making peace if you're saying, me, me, me. I need that back. It's me. You've wronged me. You need to make this right. I demand that you fix this. Now I do want to take just a quick note here and say, listen, we're talking about civil matters. Paul, in context specifically with a lot of the wording he uses here in 1 Corinthians 6, is talking about civil matters. I'm not talking about evildoers and crime. I'm not talking about rape and murder. Listen, we don't have like a jail down in the basement of the church where the church just locks them up and we all get together at a little tribunal and say, this is what we're going to do. We're going to feed them breadcrumbs for 10 years. We do not have that right. The Word of God speaks against that as well. In fact, in Genesis 9, God imposes government. He imposes penal code and says, listen, if you shed man's blood, your blood will be shed by man. And he gives right to a government. And it carries on all the way through what we see to Romans 13. And Paul says, hey, the government does not bear the sword for no reason. There comes a time when, since you aren't living like a believer, murderer, that we will turn you over to the world to be judged by the world to serve their consequences, because we don't want you here. We're going to pray for you, but we can't have that here. This is the truth. So don't hear me say, oh, I guess we just never call the cops. No, not at all. There's times to call the police. But hopefully it's not on each other in the church over the silliest of things. So often that get what's ours, it just overtakes us. That's mine. I need to get what's mine. Because we're missing the big picture. We're missing the big, big promise of God. Matthew 19 says, so Jesus said to them, assuredly, I say to you, in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel, and everyone who has left, listen real carefully here, everyone, not most, not some, everyone, every believer who has left houses or brothers, sisters, or fathers, mothers, or wife, or children, or lands, or money, or stuff, or their rights, or the wiffums, which means what's in it for me if you're new here, anything, they shall receive 100-fold in this life. He's not referring to eternity. In this life, my children will live abundantly, because that's what I came for, John 10 tells us, abundantly. And inherit eternal life. But those who put their rights first, they're going to be last. Those who submit to Jesus Christ and humble themselves before him, they're going to be first. This is just what Scripture says. Those of us who are willing to step back and give up, take my son, King Solomon, please don't cut him in half. Let her have him. This is her son. Let her have him. That this filth wouldn't happen. That this thing wouldn't happen. That's a big heart. Matthew 5 says, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Oh, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. You missed. You forgot this one. Oh, thanks. How about this one? Right? You know, that sounds silly. Yeah, but that's just what it says. This is what Jesus is promoting. He says, listen, if anyone wants to sue you, now he's using the same language as Paul. If anyone wants to sue you, take you to court to get your tunic, which is just your shirt. It's not that big a deal. He says, check it out. Don't even make him take you to court. Give him your cloak also. And if you know what was going on contextually in the Hebrew culture, these guys were shepherds. They lived outside. Their cloak was important. It was expensive. It was probably a whole head of cattle slaughtered and tanned and formed for them. And then probably a bunch of sheep and all the wool and linen. This was their thing. This was my protection. I sleep out in the fields with this to watch my flocks at night. It was such that in Old Testament law, if you gave your cloak, someone knew you were serious. You're like, I'll give you my cloak until I can repay you. They're like, oh, I know he's going to pay me back. He's coming for the cloak. No one's giving up the cloak, especially when you're not rich. This is their prized possession. He says, they're coming for your tunic and court. Don't even take them to court. Just say, here, have my cloak too. Have my cloak too. That's radical. That's over the top. Well, that's way too much. I know. That's basic Christianity. This is the bottom line. These are not radical Christians. This is Peter and Paul and James and Andrew and John, fishermen, bumblers, just coming to the Lord. Basic Christianity. He says, whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with them too. Roman law allowed them to take anyone in subjection to them and say, hey, I'm tired. You, come here. Carry my pack and my gear for 1 mile. I'm tired. I need a break. And they get to the end of that mile, and hopefully that brother or sister's been talking with them, maybe getting to know them a little. Hey, I see our first mile's up. Fitbit told me so. You want to go too? I'll carry it. Let's keep going. Okay. What a witness. What a testimony to go above and beyond for those you're in subjection to who don't like you, From him who asks, from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. It's really weird. He doesn't say to those who need something, loan it to them and ask for it back. In fact, he says to those who want it and give it to them. They say borrow. He says, just give it to them. Let them have it. Don't ask for it back. Luke 6 is very similar, but I want to read it because I really like the end line in it. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully use you. To him who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who asks of you. And from him who takes away your goods, do not ask them back. And just as you want men to do to you, you also to them do likewise. Right? Well, we preach this from kindergarten. Public schools preach this. The golden rule, little boys and girls, the golden rule. That's it. Do likewise to them what you want them to do to you. Do you want them to have value? Show them value. Do you want them to understand that you're greedy and selfish? Take them to court. This is how this works. It has to start with God's wisdom. And if he shows you there's a time that the court has to get involved, sometimes it happens. But it shouldn't be the general rule of thumb for the church. Jesus is telling the church here to treat those outside of the church blessedly. Pray for them. Those who revile you, pray for them. Those who curse you, bless them. Serve them. If so outside of the church, how much more do you think he intended within the church of those who claim the same God and the same power? Both Gospels go on to say that we need to be merciful, therefore just as God is, and be perfect, therefore just as God is. It's a really hard one to put on your shoulders. God says to be perfect. Jesus says to be perfect, therefore just as your heavenly Father is perfect. It's a heavy load. But he is trying to reconcile all things under Christ, Colossians 1 tells us. All things reconciled under Christ. He's not trying to get us to reconcile all things. He is trying to reconcile all things through Christ. Don't get in his way. Let's not get in his way. Verse 7 is a killer. We're going to close up on this. Verse 7 back in the main text, just in case you've already forgotten it, because I know it's been 40 minutes. But look at it again. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. You failed, church. We failed. Why do you not rather? Listen, this is Paul's words as the Holy Spirit impresses on him. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? That's a lot. Luke 12, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That's the bottom line. Lord Jesus, please help us, Lord. I deal with selfishness, Lord. I know that my brothers and sisters deal with selfishness. Lord, we want retribution. We want vengeance, Lord. We want reconciliation. We want recompense right now. I want it now, Lord. I want to cast ourselves upon you, throw our cares upon you, fall onto the rock who is Jesus Christ and be broken before the stone has to fall on us and crush us to powder. Lord God, help the church to reconcile within the church. Lord, we got to take our wrongs to you. We've got to take our wrongs to each other. I don't really know a good way to do it, Lord. I'm miserable most times. I'm frail. I don't do a good job. So I'm asking that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on our body this morning. Help us to forgive. Help us to be forgiving, Lord, in all things. Help us to ask for forgiveness when we've wronged. Help us to let go of our rights. To live for you, Jesus. Thank you for your mercy and your grace that has overridden all things, as your word says, Lord. Where sin abounded, grace abounded all the more. We love you. Put all we have in your hands. In Jesus' name, all of his saints said, amen.